All over the internet are these little scammy ads about candida and yeast. Discover the one little symptom that's causing your candida overgrowth. Now, candida and yeast symptoms are very, very common in people. And I don't think they're that special. I don't think they're that new. And I do find that they are mostly very treatable with Chinese herbs and formulas. Now, in this video, I thought I would talk about this topic a bit more because it is one of the most common issues my patients come in with. And one of the things that I find is very treatable with Chinese herbs, but people come in with, I think, a very flawed philosophy of why it happens and how to make it go away for good, because these symptoms so often keep coming back. So I thought I would share this, my experience, in today's video. Hey guys, Dr. Alex Heyne, author of the health book, Master of the Day, Chinese medicine doctor. Now, before we jump into this video, there are two very important links right below it. The first is if you'd like to become a patient of mine locally in Los Angeles or virtually via telemedicine, you can reach out and contact my private practice right below this video here. And the second is for a free guide, which is four daily rituals that could potentially help you add years to your life with Chinese medicine. So let's begin with the idea that candida and yeast are not new. It was candida back then, now it's SIBO, and these kind of yeast issues are issues that people chronically have. They're not new, they're not any different, they're not any more difficult or less difficult to treat than they were historically. And I say this as someone who's always been one of these SIBO-prone people. I've always had some degree of gut problems my entire life, which is what led me on this quest around the world, and which is what led me to Chinese medicine, especially internal medicine with Chinese formulas. That's the thing I found the most helpful. Certain people are just predisposed to this, which is why, for example, I was raised in a healthy family where we always ate healthy and we never ate out, and my parents always cooked and had properly sourced foods. And even when I went away to college, I was still cooking healthy food from day one. And here, 15 years later, I'm still cooking my food most days of the week. But despite all that, I just never had good digestion, and I was always complaining about it. And any parents that have young kids will see this. If you have two kids side by side, you give them the same thing. Could be healthy food. And one kid is always complaining about their stomach, and the other kid isn't. So there is definitely a genetic constitutional predisposition that people have. The symptoms that I had, these days, they would just call SIBO, right? Small intestine bacterial overgrowth. And they would be treating it the exact same way, right? Conventionally, they often use a narrow spectrum antibiotic like rifaximin. Even GI doctors will do that sometimes, sometimes using medications or even antidepressants for gut problems. But the symptoms were no different than they are today. So this is not a new problem. There's always been this kind of issue for people. I'm sure it has only skyrocketed and increased in frequency for a lot of reasons, but these aren't new, okay? Candida, yeast, SIBO, all basically the same thing, not new. Now, the second important point here is that for most people, these are constitutional. Constitutional means there's always going to be a genetic tendency towards this problem throughout your life. If you are suffering from this extensively, you have a predisposition towards it. Chinese medicine, we call it your constitution. It is your genetic makeup you've inherited from your parents, and almost always these kinds of things run in families. Now, you may not know because your mom or your dad or whoever, or grandma, maybe is always popping Pepto-Bismol, but she doesn't complain about it very much. But almost always these kind of issues run in families because they are constitutions. What happens is a certain percentage of the population is predisposed towards these kind of yeast and gut issues, where they're very sensitive to starches and sugars and carbs, and they're very prone to getting severe bloating, more abnormal bloating than the average person in the population is. And so the average person may be able to eat a burger or something very starchy, and maybe they get a little bit of bloating, but after a bowel movement, they're fine. But people who are predisposed and sensitive to this may get such severe bloating they lose all appetite for the rest of the day. Or they get such severe bloating they're almost nauseous. Or such severe bloating that they can't even take a full breath, they're so bloated. So this is obviously the next level of bloating versus just being a little bit of bloated. So the most important factor, number one, is constitution, which means if you've been suffering with this for a long time, you're always going to have a tendency to this. You can easily rebuild your gut to a point where it's effectively not there anymore, but your gut's always going to be your weak point forever. But you can get it to a point where it's very functional and it doesn't bother you on a daily basis. There will be fluctuations, but because it is constitution, it's always going to be your Achilles heel. So let's talk about dietary principles that help. Like I said, the most important factor that I found was really taking Chinese formulas long term. So that's what I specialize in. But in terms of digestive diets, you know, elimination diets, there are some that I found to be very helpful. I haven't found them to be permanently able to resolve the condition. Most often, people are like myself. I was on and off a digestive elemental, kind of like a Spartan diet for about 10 years. but after 10 years, I was still suffering from it. And I never had really normal digestion until using Chinese formulas in combination. So there are two that I would recommend. The first is a very low carbohydrate diet, even in just in the short run. So very often when people get this acute gas production and they're severely bloated, the fastest way that you can help that decrease is by removing all starches just for a week. So go very low carb and it will reduce that abdominal fullness and that abdominal bloating. So that may mean swapping your morning oatmeal just for eggs and, you know, avocado or even eggs and bacon if you just want to do that for a couple days, something tasty. It may mean that, you know, most of your kind of breakfast you're going to have to eliminate and just do something that's just traditionally meat and plants, something like that. So this is definitely harder if you're vegetarian or vegan, because I do see that vegetarians and vegans are more prone to this than meat eaters, for sure. I see that all the time. So very low carbohydrate diet for most people ends up leaving meat and plants, cooked plants. Now, that's just one piece, right? Because that's not a permanent fix. And most people will not feel that well being low carb for a long period of time. It's just very difficult to maintain. The second one I would recommend is the specific carbohydrate diet. There's a great book called Breaking the Vicious Cycle by Elaine Gottschall. And this was really the book that helped me the most over 10 years, where I would go on and off this diet all the time. If my symptoms were bad, then they were good again, and then bad, I would really undulate back and forth. But this effectively is the same thing. You're going to be removing certain food groups that are mostly the starchy foods that result in gas production, because the gut bacteria like munching on them, and it produces all this gas. So for a lot of people, following the specific carbohydrate diet or a very low carbohydrate diet is really the fastest way to remove those SIBO symptoms. Again, in my experience, it's not a cure unless you could do that for years. And most people can't, myself included. But having a middle of the line, acceptably good diet with Chinese herbs was for me the most effective thing I did. And that's what I practice and that's what I do for myself. I don't have a very low carb diet anymore. Unless those symptoms get so severe that I'm so bloated and uncomfortable, then I will do that for a couple days. But it's not sustainable to me like it isn't for most people. Those are my suggestions. Remember, it's constitutional, which means it's going to keep coming and going unless you had damage by repeated rounds of antibiotics or something like that. For most people, it is a constitutional genetic thing where it's going to be your weak point. So you need to be careful and watch it longer term. And it's not something that's just going to go away and be gone forever. But these very low carb diets can help. And in my experience, layered on with Chinese formulas, you can have a very, very normal diet that's not neurotic, and you can live a normal life. Those are my two cents on Candida, yeast, and SIBO, very common conditions that are very troublesome for a lot of people. And again, before you guys go, check out those two very important links right below this video, and check out these related videos right here on this topic.